Hi, I'm Loralie Langman, Director of the Clinical and Forensic Toxicology Laboratory and the Clinical Mass Spec Laboratory, and I do consulting at the Pharmacogenomics Laboratory here at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. And I am here today talking about how to interpret urine drug tests. Alright, so we're going to talk a little bit about urine drug testing. I'm going to cover some of the drug tests that are typically ordered, and we're going to talk about a little bit about how to interpret them and understand some of the limitations of each of them. We're going to start by going over a case, and it'll be a very simple case, so not a lot of detail behind it, but a typical case. So we have a 50-year-old male who's prescribed Percocet, and ultimately the question you're asking is he taking it? I like to start simply and think about what specimen do I need to collect. And I'm going to talk about it by looking at two simple questions. The first question is the patient impaired or under the influence now? That's probably not a question you ask very often because that's something you usually think about more in the emergency department. If that does happen to be the situation, however, that's when you're going to be looking at collecting a blood or a serum sample. More often than not, the question you're going to be asking is, are the patients that I'm dealing with taking the drug? And that's when you're going to be looking at the urine samples. Yes, there are other samples that you can collect, but the most often collected sample is urine. So that's what we're going to focus on for the rest of the talk. So when we talk about this, this is when we're going to do the typical urine immunoassay screen. And that's the most often ordered screens that you collect in your situation. And here we have a set of results that you've ordered. And you've got the typical urine immunoassay screens. And you can see here that the opiates is in this situation negative. Well, let's go and talk about what this means. You're going to ask yourself, are they taking the oxycodone that is prescribed? Well, let's think about urine drug testing for a minute and how we in the laboratory do what we do. Well, there's a traditional urine drug screening takes place in two stages. There's that screen that we just saw the results of a few seconds ago. And how does that actually happen? Well, like I said, it's an immunoassay screen. And how that works is by looking for things that look like the drug that's the class that's ordered. And it sounds a little odd, but the purpose is actually to identify a negative sample. It's very unlike most other screenings that you think about when you're talking in traditional medicine. But the assay was actually designed to look for illicit heroin. Now, that's not what we really do, and they really should have called the test not the opiate test, but they should have called it the morphine screen. Because that's how it really was designed for. Therefore, its ability to detect other opiates like codeine, hydrocodone, hydromorphone, et cetera, really depends on the antibody specificity. So each manufacturer, when they make their kits, are very different one from another. So here we have an example of morphine on one side and oxycodone on the other. And you can see they look very similar to each other. But in reality, they're actually quite different. And here I've highlighted the differences between oxycodone and morphine. Now, these antibodies, as you may remember, have a very exquisite specificity, and they are very good at telling the difference between these. And if we just compare two assays, and I'll call them assay 1 and assay 2, assay 1 has a 20% cross-reactivity with oxycodone. Well, what does that really mean? Well, it means you need 5 times more oxycodone to get a positive result than you do morphine. Well, that actually sounds pretty good. Because if you use a 300 nanogram per mil cutoff, which is what most assay kits use, means you need about 1500 nanograms per mil of oxycodone. Compared to assay 2, which has about 3% cross-reactivity. Well, what does that mean? That means you need 33 times more oxycodone to get a positive result in that assay, which means you need somewhere around 10,000 nanograms per mil of oxycodone to get a positive result. Significantly different. So in other words, one kit could give you a positive result, where another one could give you a negative result. And in fact, most kits are more similar to assay number 2. So most kits actually won't pick up oxycodone very well. That being said, if we go back to our results, the opiate result being negative isn't entirely surprising when you have a patient who's taking oxycodone, which is why they actually made an oxycodone kit. And in this circumstance, you can see that the result came up presumptively positive. So now if you go back and ask yourself, was my patient taking oxycodone? You may think to yourself, I have a different result or a different thought in my head about whether or not my patient's taking the result. Now traditionally, as I said before in the laboratory, we have stages. We have stage 1, which is a screening result. Then we go on to stage 2, which is typically a confirmatory or definitive testing. Well, in the definitive testing, that's what we would, like I said, do when we have a positive result in the screening test. Or sometimes you just go ahead and order that when you know exactly what you're looking for. Why bother with a screening result if I just want to know if it's oxycodone? Now, it is important to note that not every definitive result will give you a quantitative value. It does depend on which laboratory you send it to, and that's very important. Now, quantitative results aren't necessarily required in all circumstances, and that's also very important because numbers don't always correlate to dose. They only correlate in serum results. Urine results or urine concentrations do not correlate to dose, and that's important to remember. Now, there was a practice guideline that was written and co-authored by myself and one of my colleagues here at Mayo Clinic and several of our other colleagues from around the country that talked about how the laboratory can support pain management guidelines. And one of the recommendations that came out of that was that first-line definitive testing, whether it be qualitative or quantitative, is recommended for the detection of over-the-counter, prescribed, and non-prescribed drugs for illicit substances in pain management patients. Much easier said than done, because a targeted screen, unfortunately, can take up to 3 days to get a result back because it's done in the laboratory, whether it be by one of our gas chromatographic or liquid chromatographic mass spectrometry techniques. So it does take a while to get the results back. But the pro to that is it identifies the drug with certainty. But like I said, the con is it looks for specific drugs. So it gives you a list of what drugs were looked for. But if it's not on the list, it wasn't looked for. And that's very important to remember. Now, if we go back to our result from our case, here's our confirmation results. And you can see the list of the results that were looked for. And you can see the concentration because this was a quantitative test. And you can see the list of drugs that were taken. So if we go back to our patient and you think I prescribed oxycodone, and you're asking yourself, did my patient take the oxycodone? Let's see what we think about this result. Were they taking their oxycodone or not? Well, we need to talk about and we need to think about drug metabolism. Most people get a little glazed over in their eyes when we talk about drug metabolism, but unfortunately, it's a very important thing to think about. Many of the metabolites that you can see here are also prescription drugs. And I'm just going to focus on the oxycodone because that's what we prescribed our patient. But this is a very important slide for you to remember because it contains a parent drug and its primary and minor metabolites. But if we look at the oxycodone here, you can see that oxycodone is metabolized into oxymorphone and noroxycodone. And you can see oxymorphone is metabolized into noroxymorphone. So if we go back to our patient results, you can see here that our patient does contain oxymorphone and all of the metabolites that you expect to see from this patient. But you can also see we've got some hydrocodone up here. You may be thinking to yourself, well, I didn't prescribe hydrocodone. So is this an expected or an unexpected result? Well, it is probably an unexpected thing for most people to hear this, but there's actually an acceptable impurity level in commercially prepared pharmaceutical FDA-approved drugs. And here's another very important table for you to have handy. What you can see here is an active pharmaceutical ingredient on the one side and a process impurity in the middle. You can see the allowable limits and percentages of the allowable limits. And if we focus on the oxycodone, you can see that you're allowed to have a process impurity of hydrocodone up to about 1%. Now, if we go back to our patient, you can see that the hydrocodone was less than 1%. So in fact, the hydrocodone here is possible to be a process impurity. It's the one thing that's very interesting. The laboratory got very good at measuring lower and lower levels of things in patient samples. So we almost created this problem for ourselves as we got better and better at measuring lower and lower levels. Now we go back to our patient, and if you were paying attention, I kind of snuck it in there, but this patient was also presumptively positive for amphetamines. I didn't mention it before, but I'm going to mention it now. Now this patient was also prescribed Ritalin, which is methylphenidate. So you have to ask yourself, is this an expected result or an unexpected result? Well, do we need to do something about this? I'm going to put up some more chemistry here. Sorry, guys, but I'm a chemist. I can't help myself. But here you have an example of methamphetamine, amphetamine, and you can see those drugs are related to each other. But you also have methylphenidate, which is the drug you prescribed. Now think back to what I showed you between morphine and oxycodone, and how even those very subtle changes were easily distinguishable by an antibody. If it had no trouble distinguishing morphine from oxycodone, I guarantee you that an assay looking for amphetamine, there's no way it's going to pick up methylphenidate. So that presumptive positive is not coming from the methylphenidate. So this is something you're going to want to investigate in this patient. Now, I like to think of drug screens this way. It's like looking for a needle in the haystack when you don't know what the needle looks like, or even if there's a needle at all. We in the laboratory, the more information you can provide to us, the better. It's very, very important that we get good communication between the laboratory and the clinicians. We need to know what you're looking for. If we knew you were looking for methylphenidate, we would make sure that we ordered a test that would detect the methylphenidate you were looking for. Drug screens are kind of good at finding things that you didn't know you were looking for and not good at finding things you were. Well, that seems a little counterintuitive when you think about it. So sometimes it can find things you didn't know you were looking for. For example, the amphetamine in this case, even though you thought you were going to find the methylphenidate. So they can be very, very confusing. Please give us a call. It's always a good thing to think about when you're looking for drug screens. Go back to the needle in the haystack analogy. If we have a magnet, in other words, we know what you're looking for, we can find that needle a lot more quickly. Now let's go on to another case. In this case, you have a 50-year-old female prescribed methadone. Here we have another set of immunoassay screening results. And in this case, the opiates are presumptively positive. So you ask yourself, is my patient taking the methadone? Well, I'm going to go into a little bit of terminology here, and you may already think to yourself, well, this makes a lot of sense, opiates versus opioids. Well, a lot of times they get used and sort of interchanged and they get very confused and they're often used incorrectly. Well, an opioid is a chemical substance that has any morphine-like action in the body. Then there's the opiates. Well, there's natural opiates, and those are the alkaloids that come from the poppy itself. So those are morphine and codeine primarily. There's a few others. Then there's the semi-synthetic opiates, and those are the hydromorphones, the hydrocodones, the oxycodones, the oxymorphones, and the heroin. Heroin is not naturally occurring. We make it. Then there's the fully synthetic opioids. Those are the ones that are the fentanyls, meperidines, methadones, tramadols. Now here we have our chemical structures again. These are the opiates. So these are the ones that look like or have a structural similarity to morphine. So as you can see, they all look very similar to each other. And here are the opioids. So there's the morphine as sort of a reference on the side, but there's no chemical similarity to the morphine or to the opiates. They have the pharmacology, that's why they're opioids, but they don't look anything like morphine. So here's the methadone you prescribed. So you would not expect it, and nor does it, give a positive opiate reaction. If you do a methadone test, you don't expect it to give a positive opiate test. But when you do a methadone immunoassay screen, well, in that case, it's negative. Well, that's a little bit confusing because you've really expected your patient to be positive. Well, let's investigate this a little further. If you actually go and order a confirmatory test, what comes up here is the methadone is, in fact, 175 nanograms per mil, and EDDP, which is a methadone metabolite, you can see is over 12,000 nanograms per mil. Well, two things to note here. The confirmatory methods typically have a lower limit of quantitation than the screening methods do. And if you actually look at the screening methods, a lot, like I said, screening assay may have a cutoff of 300, where the confirmatory assay may have, in this case, was 175. So it's not surprising that it was in fact negative because it's low the cutoff. But you can see here that the methadone metabolite is quite high. Well, I'm going to use methadone as an example, but it is not unique to methadone. And this is something that people forget frequently, that a lot of drugs have an excretion that is dependent on the pH of the urine. One of the things that we always recommend, and is actually recommended in those guidelines that I referred to earlier, is that we do adulterant testing. Now, adulterant testing does include specific gravity and pH and creatinine and some other things. And they maybe gave it a bad name by calling it adulterant testing because the things like specific gravity and creatinine and pH tell you more than just adulteration. Because as I said, the excretion of methadone is pH dependent. As the pH goes up, even to pH 7, which is completely normal and physiological, the methadone can actually become negative, whereas its metabolite EDDP is not affected as much by the pH and will still remain positive. So having that kind of information is very important to interpreting drug screens. And a lot of drug classes, even amphetamines, for example, and a lot of the other opiates are affected by pH. So knowing that is very, very important. And knowing specific gravity and creatinine can tell you how dilute the urine is. In other words, did the patient happen to drink a lot of water that morning? Sure, they can drink a lot of water to try and fool the drug test, but maybe they just drank a lot of water because it's really hot outside. So having that piece of information can help you interpret a drug screen, and it may or may not have anything to do with any malicious adulteration of a urine, but could just be very important to understanding what's going on. Now, as a bit of a side note, and getting into that sort of malicious adulteration of a urine, some patients who are undergoing a drug treatment with whatever particular opioid or any other substance for that matter, benzodiazepine, may say, oh, you know what, I've been a little bit non-compliant and haven't been taking my medication, but I know I'm going to the doctor today and they're going to urine drug test me. So if I take a little bit of drug and sort of sprinkle it into the sample or spike it into the sample, it'll come up positive and it'll look like I've been compliant. Well, under these circumstances, what'll happen is you'll have a high amount of the parent drug, whatever drug it was you prescribed, but you won't have any of the metabolite. And that's really important because that's why we actually look in our confirmatory methods and in some of our targeted screening methods that we look for those metabolites because we can differentiate spiking from actual compliance. So I'm going to give you a few tips. If you're looking for a specific drug, tell us. We can't read your mind. The more information we have, the better. It gets back to what I was saying about looking for a drug screen and the needle in the haystack. If I have a magnet, I have a better chance of finding those needles. Now, when you're interpreting a urine drug screen, those concentrations can be helpful only because I can look at those ratios and look for that amount that might be, let's say, compliance versus spiking. Or I can look for hydration status. Is it a dilute urine versus not dilute urine? Therefore, those concentrations that might be on the low side make a little bit more sense. Looking at metabolic ratios, looking at whether it's contamination or contamination from the drug itself or any of those other situations are very helpful. But what you can't do is relate a urine concentration back to dose. But within a given patient, you may have a certain amount of stability, and you can use that to your advantage. So what you can do is look at urine results over time. You'll see some ups and downs in a patient over time. And yes, it does fluctuate with the creatinine and, like I said, the hydration status. And you can see in this particular patient, you have some results that are a little bit lower and a result that's a little bit higher. But if you try and look at it in relationship to the creatinine, it's going to go up and down too. And if you kind of look, you still have a couple of results that look a little bit low. Now you can say, well, if you divide it by the creatinine, which you may or may not want to do, it's not always appropriate to do, but if you do try and do that, you can see there's sort of a range that might fit with this patient. But you have a couple of results that seem a little bit low. Well, this is when you have to stop and think for a minute. You don't automatically jump and think, oh my goodness, something's terribly wrong, because it tells you something has changed. Maybe that person had a disease or an illness. They got the flu. Maybe they were taking some medications that induce or inhibit metabolism. We all remember those cytochrome P450s from back in medical school. Maybe it changed the metabolism during that period of time. Yeah, it could be altered compliance, but all it really means is you need to have a discussion with your patient. Something may have changed. So here we are getting to the end. The key to understanding and interpreting drug screens is really a few key points. Know what the lab can and can't detect, but more importantly, let them know what you need. What are your patients on and what do you need to be able to detect? Drug screens really require good two-way communication. Now, it sounds a bit weird and a little bit obvious that a positive result tells you whatever drug was found, it tells you that they probably took it, but it can't tell you when it was taken and it can't tell you what dose was taken. Now, also equally as important is a negative result doesn't exclude the possibility that they took that drug. It could be that it was below the detection limit of the assay, or it could be that that drug wasn't detected in the assay that was ordered. Now, what's also important to know is it can tell you what active drug was taken, but it can't tell you a formulation. So if you said your patient was taking Percocet, I can tell you it was oxycodone, but I can't tell you what formulation it was. Now, here's the one everybody usually gives me a big groan when I tell you. I can't test for diversion. Everybody's like, what? All I can do is I can tell you a patient took a drug. But if they didn't take it, I can't tell you what they did with it. Diversion means that they're selling it or doing something with it. I can't tell you what they did with it. All I can tell you is if they took it or they didn't take it. I know, it might be a little bit of semantics on that one, but it's true. Also, you have to remember, and I can help you with at any time, is the right test ordered? And this is why I'm here. If you ever need some help about which test to order, give me a call. And this is where you get into that discussion of opiates versus opioids and what tests are available and what drugs are being detected in what tests. Remember, relating a urine concentration to a dose is very, very difficult because of the concentrating ability of the kidney, hydration status of the patient, timing of collection, and I could keep going with that list. Now, yeah, there's sort of an intuition about higher levels, recent or higher doses, but really, you can't tell a urine concentration and a dose. Other things to remember are additional tests required, getting back to the adulterant testing, specific gravity, creatinine, pH. And is it necessary for chain of custody? I can't answer that. That's very unique to practice. But most of the time, it's not required for most circumstances. So I'd like to leave you with this thought. One ought every day to hear a song, read a fine poem, and if possible, to speak a few reasonable words. And this quote by Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. I hope I managed to do that today. Thank you very much for listening.